Don't you realize that the pathway in the mind, that pathway in your mind will not find peace until it is redirected by the Spirit of God, until you begin to live a new living way, the power of grace over your life, because you'll begin to visit those dark nights of the soul. People are offended at so much that's transpired. And there's a burdensome, but Jesus has a new and living way. And the answer to it is in the throne room of grace. The throne room offers that new identity. The throne room offers the peace. The throne room, I've even said it to myself. He said, grace gives me permission to obtain the light for the soul, Arlan. I said, say that again, Lord. Grace, it's the throne of grace that gives me permission. I don't have permission without this lovely, powerful experience of the throne room. I didn't have access to it. I want you to ask that question, what will satisfy the offense in my life? What will satisfy the offense in my life? What has offended you? Let's just call it out and address it. Well, it's political, Arlan. Well, it's my children, Arlan. Well, it's my grandchildren. I can't believe they think like that. I can't believe they're saying those types of... Well, Arlan, it's the fact that God hasn't answered. Let's talk about that. Let's get it on the table, friend. Put it out there to be discussed. Because the new and the living way will not come to pass until you address what has offended you in this era. That offense, it needs to be addressed, either addressed or dismissed, because a spiritual withering has taken place. And the spiritual withering that has taken place in the earth has dried out some of the areas of our heart. It's a great day for everybody, praying that you are well. I want to greet you in the name of the Lord, and I pray that you're doing well today. It is a unique day for each and every one of us, and that we have the opportunity to celebrate what God has been doing. You know, I was reading in Psalm chapter 35. You all know that I open up with the Psalm. And so the book of Psalm chapter 34, declares, I like this version. I was reading it in a devotional the other day. For the eyes of the Lord are intently watching all who live good lives. You know, a lot of people oftentimes feel that when they're not living a good life, they don't want God to see. It's very critical that we begin to see that this behavioral thing of a transaction with God, if I do good, then God will be good. If I don't do good, God won't be good. This is one of the strangest things that has ever been hard to explain for those growing in the things of God. Look, God loves you no matter what. And He's going to love you no matter what. Here's the thing. God's watching. And there is a beautiful thing in how He celebrates His children. The ones that aren't making it, the ones that are struggling, the ones that are fighting, the ones that are maturing and overcoming certain things. He's pulling for you too. He's pulling for all of us. This is the important thing. I won't stop reading there. For the eyes of the Lord are intently watching all who live good lives. And He gives intention when they cry to Him. This is the cool thing. That good living, listen, good living, it's great for each and every one of us. But there is a consequence. God doesn't punish us for bad living. There's the consequence for bad living. Look, you can choose to live however you want, but you can't choose its consequence. And that's the thing about living a good life and living. Now, we haven't all been perfect. No, listen, there's not anticipation that everybody's going to walk on water. What am I trying to say today? If you're finding yourself watching this, I just turned this on, I'm already starting to feel certain things. Look, that's the intention of the Lord. To come in and invade those spaces to mature, grow, process during progress of different stages of our life. That's the cool thing about journeying with God. You've got to know that God loves you and that He's doing mighty things. Let me finish reading this. I'm just opening with a great psalm. The Bible says, But the Lord has made up His mind to wipe out even the memory of evil people from the earth. Yes, the Lord hears the good man or good woman when he calls to them or to him for help and saves them from all of their troubles. Listen, he saves from all of the trouble. This is the idea about how I reach out to God. When I determine in my heart to reach out to God, whether you've been living a good life or you haven't, the cool thing is that he hears. That's the point being made here. Not whether you're good or you're bad or you're not so great. This is the point. He understands that we are all His children. And for me today, I just love the fact that when I have time with God, He reminds me, I choose to eat off the portion on the table that He's prepared for me. Listen, the Bible's so clear that the Lord prepares a table before me. Now, look, I can choose to participate in this portion or that portion, the portion that I feel bad about or the portion that He has created for me to enjoy. Listen, what portions am I partaking in when it comes to the goodness of God? The goodness of God. You know what makes the description here, the good men, is that I serve a good God and that He's always good and He only knows how to be good. Today, My impression, my sense here, you know, when I opened up, I said, it's a good time. It's a great thing to be alive. It is. I think that's where we're often preoccupied with different things in the world. Sometimes the least important things, you know, but it's important that we figure out, am I okay with you? One of the psalmists, I won't go into that today, you know, the psalmist writes out, what's most important to me is not whether, how my life will turn out. And the psalmist writes it this way, what's most important to me is, are you and I okay, dear God? That's the cool thing, to find out and to discover I'm at peace with God. And when you're at peace with God, you're at peace with your fellow brethren on the earth. It's important. Think about this right now. And I want to open with a word of prayer because I feel like it's important. There are so many people on the earth that are in really dire need to know that I'm okay with God. I'm all right, and we're going to be okay with God. Let's pray. Father, I pray that wherever they find themselves today, that they'd find peace in you and rest in you. People need it beyond imagination, beyond expectation. Sometimes things don't work out the way we thought they were going to, but all of a sudden, you just have a way of making it okay. And so I pray today that the power of your presence would come and absorb all the things that make me feel not so great, not because they've not been dealt with, but because you're a good God. I thank you today. Father, I understand the power of sin. I understand the redemption. I understand the sacrifice. But more importantly, that relationship that I can have with you now because of Jesus. I pray that each person that just needs that peace of mind and peace of heart would cry out to you, as the psalmist said. We thank you for it today in Christ's name. Hey, friend, I want you to be encouraged, okay? I want you to set your heart to be encouraged today. That's what's the gist of my heart. I'm gonna go back and I'm gonna finish a series that I've been working on. We're gonna have a great time today. I want you to share the broadcast. I want you to like it. I want you to prepare your heart for worship. And I just know that we're gonna have an amazing time where the Lord, the Spirit is made Lord. The Spirit is made Lord in your atmosphere. Where the Spirit, one version says, where the Spirit is made Lord, there is liberty. There is freedom. Allow Him to come
and be made Lord in whatever atmosphere you're in. Amen. So let's prepare our hearts for a time of worship. Amen.
So So many. Thank you. Everybody, welcome to summer 2022 at the Cup.
And we're excited to announce our new upcoming events in person.
Starting July 20th, our virtual Bible study is making a triumphant return every Wednesday.
Pastor Sanchez has a new 6-week lesson for us entitled The Well, Deep Things. We're also gearing up for some family fun and fellowship.
Yep, so come on out to Will Rogers State Beach on July 31st and Victory Park on August 21st. So as we prepare to bring summer to a close, we will be back in person September 11th at a new time, 10:30 a.m.
So we're excited to bring back in-person meetings and we can't wait to see you all soon. Stay tuned for more updates in the near future.
It is now time to worship the Lord with your giving. You know, I put a smile on my face. It takes me back to when I was a little boy. Now listen, I was raised in the church. My dad was a pastor. They used to sing this gospel song, and it was just, they used to sing it clapping their hands, and it says, you can't beat God given no matter how you try. The more you give, the more He gives to you. So keep on giving because it's really true. And they used to sing, there was so much jubilation and joy. I remember it as a little boy. The Bible says that when I was a child, I thought as a child, I rationed as a child, I spoke as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. Why do I bring those two thoughts together? You know, I realize now as a man that there was joy in giving. The Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. He loves it because it's an act of worship. You see, in Old Testament times, they brought their gift offerings and their sacrifices to the temple as an act of worship. I know now that when I was a child and I felt that jubilation in the atmosphere from those grown people that were giving, it was an act of worship with joy. Listen to that. It was an act of worship with joy. Bible says in Leviticus that the tithe is holy unto God. It is holy. It's a holy thing. It belongs to the Lord. He says in Malachi, bring ye the tithe into the storehouse that there might be meat in my house. And he says, test me Go ahead. Nowhere else in the Bible does it say, test me. If I won't open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, you cannot receive. You can't contain it. There's blessing. During a time and era like this, it's so critical we are connected to God through our tithe and our offerings. It's so critical. And so at this very moment, you have the opportunity to do that. Here on our website, covenantchurch.org/give, there's a PayPal link. Please participate with joy. You can't beat God given, no matter how you try. It's time to worship the Lord with your giving. Hey everybody, welcome back. Now listen, I want to finish this, hopefully today. I've been working on this from the beginning. I had this wonderful implication that the Lord had put upon my heart to just share the word of what it was like for this new era of change, new transformation moment, the inauguration of a brand new era when people had been hurting, people had been struggling, people had been silenced, they'd been quieted, that they had been isolated. You know, here's the cool thing about isolation. Isolation brings change. I love the examples we often get with butterflies and caterpillars and the chrysalis and how it develops itself. And we've all heard the story of how you can't help a butterfly. You can't help a bird break out of the nest or a bird break out of the egg. We're not supposed to, because it's the strength. It's the strength that the wings develop in pushing past the actual chrysalis, if you will, or the actual egg shell. We're not supposed to help through that season, because that season is what builds the strength so that you can reach the elevation that you're intended to go. That's the thing about being in those places of isolation and desperation and intimation, when we have those seasons where the people of God cry out. You know, so many people have been there for the last several years. People have been crying out, where are you, God? What's happening in this decade of change? And let me slow down, because I want to rehearse this very clearly for each of us. It is important that the word, you know, and I just jumped back in from worship because by the way, it was a wonderful time of worship, but man, I really am focused on just closing or bringing so much an encapsulation of understanding that our place in those rooms, again, according to the word of God in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. This is the throne, if you will. The Bible tells me in Colossians that Christ is in me, the hope of glory. I've already quoted to you in Acts chapter 2, in John chapter 16, in John chapter 14, and he shall dwell in you. There is important things that you need to grasp as a believer, that the Spirit of God makes himself at home in you, and we will dwell with you. It's very critical that you begin to understand that the Lord takes residence in you. Of course he does. Of course he has presence in our lives. This is the thing. When Jesus shows up on the scene, you know, I started in Matthew chapter 5 with the wonderful Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Now, if you didn't watch last week, I preached on that. Oh, Lamb of God. John says it in John chapter 1 and verse 29. Oh, Lamb of God, behold, look, the Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world. The Lamb of God. What a powerful message. I won't go back into that, but, you know, I was having moments just preparing for that particular sermon on the Lamb of God. And I made reference to Exodus chapter 12 about how the heart, that heart of where I just quoted to you scripture, that he dwells in me now. And that the sacrifice that's upon the door of my heart, the Bible says in the book of Revelation that he stands at the door of my heart and he knocks, and that if anyone will open, he will enter in and make himself at home. Quoting scripture to you, chapter and verse, there is no argument here. There's clarity that you and I can have the Spirit of the living God take up residence in us. Do you know why? Because we're going to need him. You and I need the presence. We need the Spirit. We need the relationship. We need the intimacy with God. And in Matthew chapter 5, here comes Jesus on the scene. And you've got to remember, he's not a new individual. In other words, he's not somebody that just showed up. This is Mary and Joseph's boy. Okay? He's John the Baptist's cousin. You've got to realize there's history with this. Even some of them say throughout the scriptures, isn't that Mary's boy? Isn't that Joe's boy? Oh, man, who is he calling himself? Really? All of a sudden, John the Baptist, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Then he breaks out in miracles. The first miracle, water to wine. He starts breaking out into miracles. People begin to see, oh my goodness, literal, unarguable, unfathomable, true miracles. And these miracles just aren't any miracles. I mean, you talk about the vats of wine, V-A-T-S, the vats of wine. Even in the story that talks about the Cana, the miracle at Cana, the wedding, it talks about you saved the best wine for last. You got to understand how many people you were actually preparing for in the wedding. These weddings weren't just an afternoon like we celebrate today. I don't want to get sidetracked, but these were miracles that could not be argued. Jesus shows on the scene, and then the first sermon he's going to preach, blessed are the poor in spirit. Now, that's last week. I preached about the Lamb of God. There's something about the story that God took me back to about how these doors, how these thresholds in our lives prepare us. Because there's something about isolation that's been taking place. There's something about remote home opportunities, working from home, doing church at home, doing life at home. Now, some of you say, I'm not at home. Yes, we all are. Most people, when we think about how we're at home and we did life at home, we did school at home, we did all of these things at home, and we continue to do life at home. Many people are finding new rhythms because it's not like it used to be. So shopping isn't the same. Everything is attainable online and it's shipped to you. We found different rhythms and methods, and we found different habits and cycles and practices. Who we used to be is not who we are anymore. So we're not those types of people anymore. And so there's almost been, people have been calling it a reset, a restart. We preached about that early in 2020. I'm here to tell you that during that time, if I can digress and talk about that time, that shaped us, that continues to shape us. There is a continuing of shaping in the isolation time. Why? Because your screen time with your device, your screen time with your tablet, your screen time with your television, your screen time with your flat screen, your screen time with your computer. When you talk to somebody, when you communicate, it is like a silo that's created. Whether it's a social media platform, whether you're watching videos, it doesn't matter. The idea of you being shaped by yourself is described as isolation. Now, we have two words for isolation, and I'm not going to go deep into these, but stick with me. Come on, stick with me, because this is interesting when you begin to realize that there's quasi-isolation and then there's true isolation. Stick with me. I use that word quasi. Quasi or quasi-isolation is it seems like it's isolation, but it's not. What do I mean by that? Who's ever been in a room full of people, but you feel so alone? You feel so isolated in yourself. I don't belong here. I don't feel comfortable here. I don't like it here. Or I feel like I'm being rejected here. Or I don't like this school. Or my friends have been talking about me. Or this is good. That's called quasi-isolation. That means you can be in it. And you can be in a different mind space. That's called quasi. Then you have true isolation. That's where we get the story of Joseph. When Joseph was sold by his brothers and then Pharaoh, he was incarcerated. He was in prison. That's true isolation. Listen to me now. we have been through some true isolation in our own belongings, in our own habits, in our own abodes. And in there was being created this idea that God is living on the inside and He's shaping me. And through these times and these seasons, God brings encounters. And the Bible says here, He says in Exodus chapter 12, this I found very interesting because He gives Moses instruction. He gives it to Moses and He says, look, you're going to need to teach the people. You're going to need to describe to the people. And in Exodus, go there with me. In Exodus chapter 12, He begins to describe. He begins to note how people are going to need to take a posture of being isolated in a place, but they're going to be shaped in the midst of their isolation. They're going to be prepared in the midst of their isolation. When you take time to be in that throne room with God, when you've been through something, when you've been through trial, when you've been through testing, when you've been through shaping, isn't it amazing that when you come out of a season, who's ever been there? Come on, let me digress a little bit. Who's ever lost weight and felt so good about losing weight? Let me tell you something. You dropped that 20 pounds and you couldn't wait to show up so that you could show everybody, wow, doesn't this thing feel great? Wow, doesn't, because you went through something. You were in the midst of something. Perhaps you went through a relationship breakup. Perhaps you went through a challenge in your marriage and the marriage didn't survive. That's very real. Then all of a sudden, you appear. All of a sudden, wow, look how far she's come. Wow, look how far he's come. Maybe you went through a trial or a testing on the job. Maybe you went through a firing or a letting go, or the jobs have been so tough these last 2 years. But then all of a sudden you reappeared, and there was a reappearing of who you were. But they weren't around for that year. They weren't around when you were doing the stomach crunches and the sit-ups and the push-ups, and you were actually saying no to that carb, and you were saying yes to that protein. You weren't saying yes to that donut, and instead you were saying yes to the carrots. You were doing things that were shaping you and creating in you discipline. There's spiritual implications with that as well. That when you go deep inside yourself and you have an audience with God and you're taking residence with God, remember that over the door in Exodus chapter 12, have your attention yet? He says, listen, you're going to institute the Lord's Passover. Chapter 12, verse 1. Then the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, from now on, this month, the first of the most important month of the Jewish calendar, annually on the 10th day of the month. He says, stick with me, come on. He says, tell all the people, for each family to get a lamb. Not just any animal, get a lamb. If you can't afford it, listen, find another family that will share the lamb. This is the interesting thing. That while in isolation, you were preparing for purpose. You were prepared. Stick with me. You were preparing for preservation. You were preparing because it was precious. It was sacred. There's something about those moments where I've been alone. Where are you going with this, Arlan? That we have been through seasons of that. They purify us. They preserve us. Remember, this is the idea that God is bringing a reawakening to the people. He's bringing a reawakening to His people, to His. I love the household of faith is being awakened again. And there's something about having the Lamb of God. The Lamb, I talked about that last week, the beautiful Lamb of God. But there's something that happens when that blood, when I see the blood. Let me finish the story. He says, and you'll get a lamb in each family. If the family is too small, let it share the lamb with another family. This animal shall be a year old, either sheep, without any defects. On the evening of the 14th day, verse 6 says, on the evening of the 14th day of the month, all these lambs shall be killed, and their blood shall be placed on the two side frames of the door, and then above the panel of the door. Use the blood of the lamb and put it on the doorpost. And when I see the blood, I will pass over. Now listen, Passover was instituted and is still practiced to this day. I have been implying that the beautiful Lamb of God that rests inside of Arlan has also the blood that he's marked upon the doorpost of my heart. What happens in the isolation time? That's what I've been implying. What happens when God says, Arlan? I hear him. I'm like, what's going on? Oh boy. What's happening here? Watch. Stick with me. Come on. Just like the stomach crunches I just talked about. Just like the, instead of the donut, I take the carrots. Just like instead of crying and staying at home, I decided I was going to get up after that bad relationship, after being let go by my employer, after going through this trial, after going through this thing in my school, after going through this thing in my relationship, after going through the sickness and disease, this loss of family member, this loss of hope, these tensions in my relationships, after going through that, after the pain of self-discovery and finding out who I wasn't and who I am. After identifying whose I am and being reminded that God was with me. Think about that. Let's think about that. Let's just take a moment. Think about identity. Think about the loss of identity. Think about how a community, an atmosphere, a culture tried to challenge my identity. Tried to challenge telling me who I was and who I wasn't. And then until I took the place, now stick with me, just like I talked about the discipline of the stomach crunches, until I took the discipline of the intimacy going inside and saying, I went inside the heart and I said, God, would you meet with me there? And you know what he began to do? He began to strip things off of me, the lies that aren't true, the things that were said to me that weren't true. He brought truth and said, I love the fact that God brought truth. If it is God that has done the stripping, he is faithful to clothe you again. Zechariah chapter 13 and verse 1 speaks of a fountain where we are cleansed. The Bible says in John 15:3 that we are cleansed through the word of God. But see, when we wear things, when I wear what people have said about me, when I wear how I was made to be felt by a season and a time, I come out not only wearing it, I come out smelling like it. I come out bitter. I come out angry. I come out frustrated, and I push back on everybody and everything because I allowed it to consume me. This is not the Lamb of God that has put blood over my heart, that has claimed me as his, that has given me identity for him. This is not that. See, this is this where he takes away. He cleanses the mind. He cleanses. I spoke about that last week in Hebrews, that he was able to clear the conscience. That's the sacrifice of Jesus. That's the powerful thing. But the Lamb of God, the blood of the Lamb represented. I talked about this last week. I talked about how it represented purity. When I see the blood, it's pure. I'll pass over. When I see the blood, it represents preserve this one. Don't take out the firstborn in that home. Preservation. It represents precious. This house, this domain is precious. See, but when I allow things to go in, the accusation, the identification, I identify. My identity has been shaped by something other than God. My identity is not defined by anything or anyone outside of God. I belong to him and his sacrifice. This is where I spoke about the audience, how I have audience with God. That's what's going on the inside of me. And now I get to feast with him. I get to take meals with him, and he feeds me with his word. What are you talking about, Arlan? The promises he's made to me. The promises he's made on the inside of you that nobody has access to, and that nobody belongs in there but you and him. And what do? I begin to write those down. I begin to write those promises down. I begin to, because you know what? It fights, it combats the spiritual withering that would love to take place during this season. And so the number one thing I want to talk to you about, I'm almost finished, is that flourishing that happens. That flourishing that happens when I cross the threshold of going in. The Bible speaks about this in the book of Psalm, chapter, was it 77? It says, and then I entered in. It's Psalm 77. He was jealous. Who's ever been jealous? Hey, come on, let's be honest. Come on. You know, I had a moment with this particular verse myself many years ago, and I remember hearing God. He says, you know, I was asking, God, why do you always bless other people? Who's ever been there before? Who's ever been before there before? And he said, God, why is it? Why is it? Psalm 73, it says, how good is it to Israel to have those hearts are pure? But as for me, I came so close to the edge of my cliff. My feet, I'm reading from Psalm 73. Didn't have this in my notes, but I'm going to read it anyway. My feet were slipping and I was almost gone, for I was envious of the prosperity of the proud and the wicked. Every time I looked, they were prospering. Yes, all through life, their road is smooth. They grow sleek and fat. They aren't always in trouble. They aren't plagued with problems like everyone else. And their pride sparkles like jeweled necklaces and their clothing of woven cruelty. Verse 7, I love this version. It says, these fat cats, I love that, these fat cats have everything their hearts could ever wish for. They scoff at God and threaten his people. How proudly they speak. They boast against the very heavens, and their words strut through the earth. Why is it, he says in verse 10, why is it that God's people are always struggling? But then he says in verse 17, and then one day, I went inside. Then one day, I went into the sanctuary of God. What am I saying today? That the threshold of coming out of those moments of isolation, those moments of shaping, we are on the horizon of an awakening of the greatest years of our lives. What are you going to feast on? Am I going to feast on the bitter? Or am I going to feast on the goodness of God? Because the bitter herbs were inside the house. You know, interesting, the Bible says in Exodus chapter 11, it says in Exodus chapter 11 that they were to prepare their hearts. Listen, they were to prepare their hearts. The Israelites were to prepare their hearts to ask for silver, gold, clothing. They were going to leave Egypt. You are not going to put us through a season like that and not allow us to come through it. And the Bible says they did. The Bible says in Exodus chapter, turn with me there now. I want to just show you and I'm going to close. The Bible says in Exodus chapter 12, it says there, 11, he says, prepare their hearts. He says 11 verse 2, tell the men and the women of Israel to prepare their hearts to ask their Egyptian neighbors for costly gold and silver and jewelry. Chapter 11 and verse 2. The Bible says that in your Bible, chapter 11, prepare your hearts. Go with me to 12, verse 35. Chapter 12, just make a right turn. Chapter 12 and verse 35. And verse 35 of chapter 12 of Exodus. And the children of Israel did as Moses said and asked the Egyptians for silver, gold, jewelry, clothing. And the Lord gave the Israelites favor with the Egyptians so that they gave them whatever they wanted. And the Egyptians were practically stripped of everything they owned. Listen to me. There is a preparing. There is a preparation that happens when you are isolated, when you are being prepared, when you are being shaped. And I believe that is in the wonderful place of the throne room inside, the throne of grace that happens on the, that's the chamber where I find rest, where I find goodness, where I find my life. Those things are nourishing to me. And I believe, the Bible says, in Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 10, for he has dressed me with the clothing of salvation and draped me in a robe of righteousness. Think about that. Think about how God prepares you as you emerge from seasons of strain and struggle. This is the point last week that I made, that the walking sticks. Remember, I made that point. There's an issue here that is very critical. The Bible says that when they were going to kill the lamb, they were to actually roast it with herbs, bitter herbs, and they were to eat it, and nothing was supposed to be kept. Whatever they couldn't finish, they were to burn. But the Bible says in chapter 12 and verse 11, eat it with your traveling clothes on, prepared for a long journey, wearing your walking shoes and carrying your walking sticks in your hands. Eat the Passover hurriedly. I'm finished. Let me address one more thing. There's something about God preparing me. Whenever I eat a meal I know that it is to nourish me for journey. Think about that. The Bible says in the book of 1 Kings chapter 19 that Elijah was awakened by the angel of the Lord that had prepared for him. Think about this. Amelia said, for the journey is great for you. There's something about a feast whenever God allows you to partake of a feast. It's because he was preparing you to cross the threshold. Whenever you do that, be prepared. Be prepared because it's a precious season, because it's a purpose season, because it's a preserved season, and because it's a purified season. Think about that. I believe in my heart we have been through so much, but God has prepared us for this season. Now, I believe that throne room, that place where I have audience with God, where he speaks to me. His word is secure. His word is inspired. His word is encouraged upon me. Now listen, there's a lot of battling going on right now. There's a lot of struggle going on, a lot of arguing going on. My prayer for you today is that you would participate in conversations and in arguments that don't belong a part of your life. Wrap your mind around the presence of God. I know this sounds super spiritual at times, but I can't tell you some of the times where I've struggled the most with news, or people call me, Arlan, I need to take a call with you. And you know, sometimes they want to give me the most devastating news. I've interrupted the stories that they're telling me, that this happened and that happened. You know what? I'm going to pray right now. You can join me, or you want to end the call, fine. But I just go into prayer. Lord, we just ask you right now. I go, quick. I just go to God. And I know that sounds uber spiritual, but it's not. It's not. It is my rhythm. It is my habit. It is the way I have decided to live out my life. Because I have nothing. I have no one but him. And he's the one that will give me the wisdom to make the decisions I need to make at the moment I need to make them. Today, I'm asking you to consider, where is your intimacy with God? Do you see yourself in a place of pure thinking, preservation? Do you think you've been prepared for preservation for a season like this? Do you think that the season of your life is precious? It is precious. And do you believe that it's purposed? I believe that the wonderful love of God over my heart has been developed for a purpose and a design. Now let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you're good and that you're speaking loud and clear. I ask in your precious name, speak louder than you've ever spoken before to each and every one of us. Oh God, come, make yourself at home. Let me have audience with you, God. Let me be robed with righteousness, God. Teach me to hear you. Teach me to have identity in you. In Christ's wonderful name, amen. All right, friend, hey, listen. I want you to listen. I want you to allow this to minister to you and allow this to speak so loudly over you that you begin to hear the voice of God in the midst of inviting him. It's important right now because identity is being challenged all over the place, and I believe it's important that we find our identity in Christ. Amen? All right, have a great one. Please share the broadcast. Please make sure you like it, and have a great and blessed day. We'll see you soon.